Hey everybody, I'm John Luke, pastor of Salem. Welcome in the name of Jesus. I'm so glad you're joining us for this time of worship. I want to invite you to join with us each week and to connect with us on social media or especially at salemchurch.life. That's a great place for you to take your next step. I want to also encourage you to consider sharing this video with others. It's as easy as a click to share Jesus with others. And if you happen to be one of the persons who received this on DVD, you can always pass that DVD along to someone else to share Jesus with others too. It's great to be together. Lights went out. I'm prepared. I got this. Got mine. Supposed to be prepared for stuff like this. If anything, that's what the derecho taught us back in August. Oh my goodness. Welcome.
Jesus promised to send us the Holy Spirit to be an advocate for us. So let us invite the Holy Spirit to come and blow through this time of worship and move in us as God's people. I feel it in my bones, you were about to move. Feel it in the wind you're about to ride in. Said that you would pour your spirit out. Said that you would fall on sons and daughters. So come. Feel it in the wind, you're about to ride in. please pray with me? Almighty God, our hearts are open. You know all of our desires, for we can never hide any secret from you. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and magnify your holy name in a way that is worthy to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
We turn now to the Gospel of Matthew and the 25th chapter. We're going to read the first 13 verses. This is the parable of the 10 bridesmaids, five of whom were wise and five of whom were foolish. We've been reading this fall stories by Jesus, short stories by Jesus, and they've been about the kingdom of heaven. This was back in Matthew chapter 13. Each of those stories began with the kingdom of heaven is in the present tense, happening now. Here in the 25th chapter of Matthew, that changes just a little bit. Jesus says, then the kingdom of heaven will be like, future tense, what's going to be happening in the future. And that word then is important. Theologian Stanley Hauerwas, he says that the word then signals to his disciples that they must learn how to live in light of his death and resurrection. Hear these words, this short story by Jesus. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a shout, "Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet. And the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The motto of the Boy Scouts is, "Be prepared." Be prepared. Someone once asked Robert Baden-Powell, he's the founder of Scouting, what are you supposed to be prepared for? And he replied, "Well, any old thing, really." In other words, the training you receive in your troop will help you be prepared for anything. For instance, when someone has an accident, you're prepared because of the first aid instruction that you've received. My mom taught me to be prepared for an accident too. She said, "Always wear clean underwear in case you're in an accident. You never know when that might happen." Of course, I never really understood that because I figured if I was in an accident, my shorts might not be so clean anyway. Being prepared for something, though, that means then you're waiting for it to happen. This story of the 10 bridesmaids, it was written for Matthew's community. And that was a community that was waiting for Jesus to come back. And you know, those first Christians, those early Christians, they really thought that Jesus was going to come back immediately. So it felt like this really big delay when Jesus didn't return right away, when his return was longer than anticipated. They were waiting through the night for Jesus's return, much like the 10 bridesmaids, so to speak, as they were waiting for the groom. And you know, the same thing for us, right? We're waiting through the night as well. In fact, we're waiting 2,000 years for Jesus to come back and return. So how do we live as followers of Jesus during this time while we're waiting? How do we live so that we'll be ready when Jesus does come back? How will we be prepared for that full reign of God in the kingdom of heaven Jesus says the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom, the groom. Now, a first century wedding was a major event and celebration in a village. Of course, the bride and the groom, they dressed in special clothing. They were decked out with jewels and even crowns on their heads. So a procession left from the bride's home and another procession left from the groom's home. And they met in sort of this wonderful, joyous union in the streets. And it became this big parade then all throughout the village. It was a wonderful, wonderful time. It could last for days with wonderful feasting and dancing. It was a very, very special time. But during all this, at some point, the groom stopped over at the bride's home to have a conversation, a meeting with the father of the bride. And remember, of course, this is patriarchal culture. But the groom and the father of the bride, they met to make arrangements, you know, for the transfer of the bride's property. And perhaps that's what's going on here in this story from Jesus. Maybe the negotiations between the groom and the father of bride, they're taking longer than expected. There's kind of this delay in the groom getting to the party. And the young women, they're just waiting there. They're waiting to light the way with their lamps to sort of have this festive moment in the wedding. And with the groom delayed, they got drowsy and they fell asleep. Nothing wrong with that. They fell asleep. And then all of a sudden, it was about midnight, the call rang out, "The groom is coming! The groom is coming!" The bridesmaids, they got up and they trimmed their lamps. And that means that they would have paid some attention to the wicks, caring for the wick that drew the oil up for the flame. But it also meant filling the reservoir with the extra oil to keep the lamp burning for hours. Five of these young women, five of these bridesmaids, they were wise because they took along extra oil for their lamps. They were prepared. The groom had been delayed, but they were prepared for that. They had extra containers of oil in order to refill the reservoirs of their oil lamps. They were able to keep their lights burning. Now, five of these maidens were foolish because they weren't prepared, right? They weren't prepared. They didn't have that preparation of bringing along extra oil. And so they weren't able to keep their lamps lit. And they wanted the five wise young women to share their oil with them. But the wise bridesmaids who were prepared, they said, "Well, we can't share ours. There won't be enough for everyone, and then there won't be any light for us to have this sort of festive moment when the groom arrives." And so the five foolish bridesmaids, they had to run over to Target to try and buy some oil for their lamps. The wise young women, they were prepared and they were ready when the groom arrived. Yep, the groom had been delayed, but they were prepared for that. And when he did show up, then they went right on in with him into this wonderful marriage banquet celebration. And it's just so beautiful, and the food looked so good, and it smelled delicious. And it was just such a place of love and joy and beauty and wonder. They went into this wonderful marriage banquet celebration, and then the door was shut. What a terrible sort of finality with that door closing shut. That's it. The door is closed. And when the five foolish maidens returned from Target, they started knocking on the door. "Lord, Lord, let us in, let us in." But the groom replied, "Not by the hair of my chinny chin chin." No, no, that's a different story. But the groom said, "No, I don't know who you are." I mean, what a heartbreaking, tragic moment that is for the bridegroom, Jesus, to say, "I don't know who you are." And that's just what Jesus had said near the end of his Sermon on the Mount. He said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who do the will of my Father." And so Jesus ends this short story with this final warning. Keep awake, stay alert. Keep on your toes, do what you need to. You don't know when the groom will return. This parable, this short story by Jesus, it's an invitation to a wonderful celebration. And we get that with the wedding imagery. But it's also a story about judgment. It's judgment against those who are unprepared for the arrival of the bridegroom Jesus. For Jesus to show up and with him the coming full reign of the kingdom of heaven, God's rule. At the beginning of the story, it appeared that all 10 of these young women, all 10 of these bridesmaids were prepared for the coming of the groom. But in the end, half of them weren't. So how does this story form us? I mean, that's what we want here. We want to be shaped and formed by these stories of Jesus. So how does this story form us? How are we to live during this delay of Jesus' return? And how will we be ready? How will we be prepared for when Jesus does come again? Well, first, we're invited to bring our lamps. And this lamp light, it recalls Israel's task to be a light to the nations. That's what the prophet Isaiah says. Israel is to be a light to the nations. God gives Israel as a light to the nations. Now the church, that's Matthew's community and our community, Salem, and the entire Christian community in the world. The church, you know, we share that same mission to be a light to the world. Jesus says to us, you are the light of the world, a city set on a hill. And he goes on, he says, you know, nobody lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket to hide that light. No, you put that out on the lampstand so it can bring light for the entire house. And we're to be that light for the entire house or the entire world. And to be light for the world means to embody Jesus in the world. We are the body of Christ in the world. Showing the world, you know, what it is that God offers. Showing the world what it is that God wants. It's showing the world what it means to really be the world that God intended in creation in the first place. We're to be an example of that rule of God. And that means we're to be a blessing, a light in the darkness. So we're invited to bring our lamps as we wait. And second, we're taught to bring extra oil for our lamps, for that lamp light. And for Matthew, that extra oil, it represents preparedness as a disciple. It's the faithful, active, obedient practices of discipleship. And so that's why it can't actually be borrowed from others. You know, we hear this story from Jesus, and we might wonder, well, why didn't those wise, prepared young women, why didn't they do the Christian thing, the loving, caring thing, and share their oil with the five who were unwise? But you see, this story about these five, it's about our active, faithful, obedient discipleship. And that's why you can't borrow or take or use someone else's oil light, because it represents someone else's discipleship. It's not that those five wise young women were somehow unchristian or unloving or uncaring, mean people who wouldn't, you know, help take care of someone else. It simply means they had their discipleship. The foolish ones were the ones who didn't. And they couldn't just borrow someone else's discipleship. Earlier in Matthew's gospel, again, it's near the end of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, Jesus tells us a contrast between wise and foolish people. And he says, you know, the wise, they're the ones who build their homes on the rock. That is, hearing and doing what it is that Jesus says. The foolish, they're the ones who hear what Jesus says, but they don't do anything about it. They don't act on his words. And so they build their homes on the sand, and the storms destroy their lives. Jesus says back there in the Sermon on the Mount, that's the contrast. That's the difference between wise and foolish. The wise are disciplined to hear and understand and act on Jesus' words. That's what it means to be bringing the extra oil for our light in the world. And that says something for us. That should be how this story sort of shapes and forms us, because we're living in this same delay waiting for Jesus to return. And Jesus tells us to be ready, to be prepared. And that's why we practice certain things as disciples of Jesus. As Methodists, John Wesley taught us to practice what he called the works of piety. The works of piety, you know, that's prayer. It's praying and reading scripture, worshiping. It's participating in small group conferencing or conversation. It's receiving Holy Communion. It's fasting. It's all these sort of works of piety. That's what John Wesley taught. And along with the works of piety, Wesley also taught us to practice the works of mercy. And that's easy. That's just doing good. I mean, that's what it comes down to. It's providing food and clothing and water and medical care. And it's working for justice and for healing and for peace. You know, sort of trying to do whatever we can for the wholeness and completeness of life for all people everywhere. It's just doing good. We have the works of piety and the works of mercy. And you see, that's why we're called Methodists. It really wasn't a nice name originally. John and Charles Wesley, they started this holy club in college, and they followed this method of discipleship. They were so methodical in following Jesus that others began to deride them and make fun of them and call them names. And the name they said was, "Look at those Methodists. They're so methodical. Look at those Methodists." But you know, that's a badge of honor for us today. That's a badge of honor that we are methodical, that we have a method of following Jesus. In the first church that I served as an ordained pastor, there was a wonderful, dear Christian man. I loved him a lot, really wonderful. I disagreed with him about one thing, just one thing. He didn't think that we should pray the Lord's Prayer every Sunday in worship. He thought it was this example prayer, like Jesus was saying, here's an example of the way to pray, but you should come up with your own words and figure out how to pray on your own. And two, you know, it can be recited by rote, just kind of mechanically without thinking much about it, and persons might not even really mean it when they're praying this prayer. They might just be saying the words. And of course, he had a point, right? He had a point. But praying the Lord's Prayer week in and week out, or even every day, is preparation to pray. We pray the Lord's Prayer by heart every week, week after week, because one of these days there's going to be a moment in your life when you will need more than anything to be prepared to pray, and you will know what to say. You will know how to begin to talk to God. Our Father, who art in heaven. I mean, that's what it means to practice, to be prepared. Theologian Ellen Cherry, she says, it takes until age 8 or 10 for a child to really want to brush her teeth twice daily. I mean, in the long run, that discipline of brushing 2 times daily, it gives way to the realization that you're doing something really good for your dental health. You're healthy and you're whole. You have this clean mouth and it's fresh and it's such a good thing. And you come to really take pleasure in that. And she says it's similar with our spiritual health. Reflecting on the quality of our life before God, that is a taste to be cultivated. It is a discipline to be practiced. So, what are you doing? What are you doing to practice following Jesus? What is the method of your discipleship? I mean, do you have your lamplight and that extra oil? Are you prepared for Jesus coming at any moment? One thing we know from this story and from all of these short stories we've heard from Jesus this fall, the church is a mixed body. We are. We're not some sort of pure group of people. We are a mixed body. We're a mixed body of the wise and the foolish. And you don't know who's in each group. You don't. But the day is coming when we will be separated. There will be a judgment. will be separated. And the question is, where do you want to be? I mean, are you okay being on the outside of that door that is closed with such finality? Or do you want to be inside, in that celebration, in that marriage feast, that banquet with the groom? Be wise. Keep alert. Keep a supply of extra oil to keep your lamp burning. Let your light shine. That is, keep listening to Jesus and living it out in your life and in our life together in community as we witness to the rule of God, that is, that full reign of the kingdom of heaven, because that is what it will be one day. Be prepared.
Would you pray with me? O Lord, our God, grant us grace to desire you with our whole heart, that so desiring we may seek and find you, and so finding you we may love you, and loving you we may hate those sins from which you have redeemed us, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for your kingdom to come, here on earth as it is in heaven. Help us to be wise and prepared as we wait. Show us what you are doing, Lord, and allow us to be a part of it. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the people of this land and of all nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. And we pray for those who won elections last week, not because we agree or disagree with their election, but because we seek your peace in our land and throughout this world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all in the path or the wake of the novel coronavirus as cases, hospitalizations, and deaths continue to grow in our country, our state, and our nation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for ourselves, our families, and those we love, especially today, Andrea Nienau, her family and friends, whose husband Scott's funeral service was yesterday. Andrea Nienau, who, in addition, is recovering from a medical procedure last week. For my brother-in-law, Mike, who has been diagnosed with lung cancer. For Barb Sukup, who requests prayers for Kimberly, who is at the University of Iowa Hospital with cancer. For Melinda Gipple's father-in-law, Danny, who had surgery last week at Mayo. For Jody Hansen and her daughter, Melissa, who have tested positive for COVID-19. And for Rhonda Johnson's dad, Ron, who is in the hospital with COVID-19. And let us pray now for those we lift up to the Lord silently in our hearts and minds, and for those we lift up aloud with our voices. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, Jesus is coming, but we know neither the day nor the hour. Help us be awake as we await our heavenly bridegroom. Help us to be ready, to be prepared. Fill our blind hearts with the insight that sees beyond Christ's delay. Replace our foolishness with wisdom, our pride with faith, our slumber with wakefulness. We pray in the name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, and who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
Thanks for joining with us for worship. I want to invite you to join us again next week. Be sure to connect with us on social media or at salemchurch.life. Also want to invite you to share this worship video with others. It's as easy as a click to share Jesus with others. Also, next week, not this week, but next week is the third Sunday of the month, and so we will be offering Holy Communion, that sacrament, online with a live video. We're going to be doing that every month, the third Sunday of the month. The first Sunday of the month, we're going to be offering what we've been doing now, this in-person drive-through Holy Communion in the parking lot. Even during the winter, that'll be weather permitting, of course, but we can stand out there in the cold with our coats as we serve that. So the first Sunday of the month will always be the drive-through Holy Communion in the parking lot. The third Sunday of the month, like next week, we will be sharing Holy Communion online. We'll do that for as long as our bishop continues to give us her blessing to do that. And that's a good way, especially if you're not able to come that first Sunday for drive-through. If you're located somewhere else, we want to encourage you. You could be prepared with some bread and some juice. That'll be next Sunday, right after our live video. All right, I invite you to receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.